So some of the issues related to time domain substitution that you should be aware of. I didn't talk much about the calibration that we applied when we made our measurement of our DUT. Calibration that we like to use in a scenario like this is a harmonic calibration. And what harmonic means is the first frequency in your frequency set, which in this case is 10 megahertz, is also the step increment between frequencies. So what we want to do is we want to make a calibration that is at 10 megahertz, 20 megahertz, 30 megahertz, 40 megahertz, and so forth. Everything's a multiple of 10 megahertz in here. So the way that we do that is we enter a start frequency of 10 megahertz, and we enter the stop frequency of whatever is of interest to you. In this case, it's 26.5 gigahertz. So then we go down to the sweep button, and for a number of points, we enter 2650, because 10 megahertz multiplied by 2650 points is 26.5 gigahertz. And that's all we mean by a harmonic cal. It's just setting up the calibration frequencies so that when we calibrate, we have a harmonic set. That's not absolutely essential to time domain substitution. And in fact, one of the things that's built into Spectro VNA Pro is if you happen to make a measurement and it's not on a harmonic set, we'll resample that data and create a harmonic set for you. But if you're calibrating anyway, you might as well do that. That's just a good practice. Another thing that might be of interest is just an explanation about the spectrogram. We didn't cover that very fully as we were explaining how to do a time domain substitution. So I'm just going to go grab from our instrument the data. There's the data. A spectrogram is created. A spectrogram has time on the horizontal scale and frequency on the vertical scale. The horizontal scale in time, you can see there's not much happening over here. So I'm going to readjust this just by clicking on the time scale and adjusting the stop time to be 2 nanoseconds in this case. So that allows the plot to show us the data of interest in this thing. The colors are the magnitude of the reflection coefficient of S11. We're looking at an S11 trace for the board that we're measuring. One of the new concepts with joint time frequency processing is the concept of res time width. Res time width is somewhat analogous to res bandwidth for spectrum analyzers. On a spectrum analyzer, you adjust res bandwidth to be a smaller number to give you more resolution. And likewise, with VNA measurements that start out in the frequency domain, we adjust the res time width to give us better resolution in the time domain. So I'm going to adjust this measurement so that the res time width is 100 picoseconds. So I'm making a measurement over 26.5 gigahertz, and I'm adjusting it so I can see about 100 picoseconds worth of resolution on our board. So when we're looking at the plot again over here, we can see a response in time that's right here. Rather than just seeing one number from a time domain response, though, we see a whole variety of colors that represent different reflection coefficients. Down the lower end, the cooler colors say that the low frequencies for the launch, this represents the launch, is the launch. Those low frequencies are well matched, and then as we go up in frequency, we get more reflection off it. Here's actually the DUT. The transmission line lies in between the launch and the DUT. Down over here is the DUT. The DUT also has a fairly good response in the low frequencies, and then the match begins to degrade as we go up in frequency from there. We can apply various tools to the display. One of the tools that we can apply is the value tool, and we click on the top crosshairs tool, and we go on here and we can ask at any moment in time, at any frequency, what's the magnitude and phase of the S11. So despite the fact that we choose to color this image according to the magnitude, it's a full complex space. Every pixel on here represents magnitude and phase at moments in time at different frequencies. Another tool that's of interest here is to take cuts through our data. So the launch is right here. This is the launch, and the frequency response of the launch might be of interest to us. So let's go over here and select the frequency domain trace. That's that up arrow with the F. And just go on to the trace and click right there on the launch. So that is the frequency response of the launch. Down in the low frequencies, it's fairly well matched. And as we go up higher and higher in frequency, the reflection off the launch becomes significant. Likewise, we can take a look at our actual DUT response. So I'm going to put the cursor right on top of the DUT and click, and that's the response of the DUT at that as a function of frequency. Now, the launch is shadowing it, masking it, and so that's not the actual DUT. We have to go through the time domain substitution process to extract that. We can also take horizontal cuts through our data. Those are time domain traces for particular frequencies. So let's go down here in the low frequency end and take a cut right through our data right near the bottom of the frequency response. So you can see down here that the launch is not even a factor at the low frequencies. There's my DUT. This is analogous to a normal time domain sort of plot. The horizontal axis is time and the vertical axis is S11 at that moment in time. So the launch is not contributing very much at the low frequencies, and my DUT is about 15 dB higher in response. If I go higher in frequency, something up here near 13 gigahertz, now my launch is becoming much more significant as a reflection as compared to my DUT. So the problem is that the launch is reflecting energy off, and so in essence it's stealing energy from the response I'm seeing from the seeing on the DUT. So that's why we have to go through a time domain substitution process to get rid of the effects of the launch, to get rid of the effects of the transmission line, and just extract the response associated with the DUT. Thank you very much for your time.